It's a huge treat to have you with us on this wonderful celebratory occasion, which of course we're holding in Mark's honour. Tonight, in fact, we're going to be celebrating three things simultaneously. The first is Mark's 90th birthday, which fell a fortnight ago. And I think it's only right that I should begin by asking you all to join me in raising your glasses and wishing Mark a belated happy birthday. Happy birthday, Mark. The second thing we're celebrating, of course, is Mark's newest book, A Biographical Dictionary of English Architecture, 1540 to 1640, which we're delighted to be publishing next week. As well as marking both these events, however, we thought we'd take the opportunity of their conjunction to do something else. That is to ask Mark to join us in celebrating the entirety of his remarkable career as an architectural historian, which of course shows no sign of abating. Most of all, however, we wanted to use tonight's event to give Mark himself the chance to talk at some length about his multifaceted career and to respond to questions about that career from you, the audience. Mark will be in conversation with a trio of friends who are all immensely distinguished architectural historians in their own right. I'm delighted to have on stage alongside me. First, John Goodall, who will ask Mark about his work on Elizabethan and Jacobean architecture. Second, Michael Hall, who will steer the discussion towards Mark's publications on 18th, especially 19th century British architecture. And finally, Catherine Croft, who will encourage Mark to tell us more about his many contributions to the field of 20th century British architecture. So, shall we start? John, over to you.
To start at the beginning, as it were, I wanted to ask Mark, first of all, about Hardwick Hall, because for those of us who were lucky enough to go to Mark's birthday party in St. Paul's Covent Garden, they will know that the birthday cake took the form of Hardwick Hall. Not exactly as any of us might recognise it, but it did nevertheless do so.
More or less.
With 90 candles on it, no more or no less. Mm. But it's clearly a building that has underpinned your entire interest, in a way, in the Elizabethan world. And I wonder if you could start by just telling us a little bit about what it means to you and your experience of it as a child.
As a child, yes, I mean, it was just extraordinary, really. But I didn't react to it architecturally at all, I don't think, as a child. But I remember looking out of the window of the nursery, which is on the top floor, at the battered ruins of Old Hardwick, and decided that there must have been a fire, it had been burnt. So when we were all set to drawing one day, I did a lovely picture of Old Hardwick with flames belching out. But I didn't really notice the architecture very much, I don't think. It was all shut up in the war, and we couldn't go there. But then I came back, when was it? When I was 12 or so, or 13, 14, and all I could think of writing to my father was, "It's beautifully tidy inside." And it wasn't, I think, it was a combination of my actually going to stay there with my Aunt Evie when she finally moved in there, and Sir Cheverel Sitwell's amazing sort of purple prose, which poured out of him about Hardwick, which first got me to see the point of it architecturally, and then more and more and more and more. And just every time I stayed there, you know, I saw, it was just so wonderful to be able to walk around it by oneself, you know, with nobody there.
You said to me that you think you remember the footmen complaining about powdering their wigs and things like that.
Yeah, I think I do. One's never quite sure whether one remembers correctly or what one's been told. And the footmen certainly didn't have powdered hair. When I was there, they were only on special occasions. So I never saw a footman with powdered hair.
And so, I mean, Hardwick, it's a building that clearly underpinned your enthusiasm for writing Robert Smithson. I mean, in fact, the enthusiasm for the buildings is the thing that shines out of your preface.
Yes.
You describe the Elizabethan world as being very unfashionable at the time. Was it a kind of conscious decision to start getting involved with it, or were you aware of the second Elizabethan age reviving and you wished to be a part of it?
I don't know, I just, you know, these things happened gradually. I just got more and more interested. And then at last the time came when I had to decide what to write my thesis on, when I decided I wanted to be an architectural historian, and Hardwick was just the obvious one. You know, there was no, and Robert Smithson, I mean, and Hardwick arising out of that. So having briefly considered James Wyatt, and I can't think why, I opted for Robert Smithson. And, you know, the more I wrote that book, the more involved I got, really.
Can you describe going and seeing these places? I mean, you know, you were working away. You did your thesis an incredible 2 years. Mm-hmm. And you talk, again, with great enthusiasm about just how exciting these buildings were. Did you sort of stop off with, you know, in Hardwick and go and visit lots of places from there in a car, or were you cycling to see these places? What was your, and what were the owners like? What was your experience of those things?
Well, I suppose Bolsover was the nearest, and to walk over to Bolsover was a wonderful, and what was so, I mean, fascinating in those days was everywhere was empty. I mean, there were no interpretation centres or anything like that. And I would walk over to Bolsover, and there was a nice old caretaker there, and it'd be just me and him in the building. I mean, obviously, it couldn't last like that, but I remember with great pleasure those days when you could, you know, I was very pleased with Wofort, what they call Wofort Towers now, when it had pigs grazing on the grass in front of it, which I photographed. It was just a funny world. It's just so different from what it is now.
Did you? You've written, of course, about your sort of teachers and the people you particularly admired when you were a student. But what about your peers? I mean, I noticed, for example, just glancing at your new dictionary, you described drinking coffee with Roy Strong at the Courtauld.
Yes.
Who were your, you know, formative peers, and were they very helpful in your lightning work as you raced through your PhD?
Well, I suppose Margaret Winnie, who was my supervisor, who was a dear person. John Summerson was my hero, really, in those days. Roy was a shy young student in those days.
Hard to believe.
And we used to have coffee together and plan our futures. And now, who else did it? Well, yes, Lucy Worsley was a great enthusiast. And I wrote a lot. I wrote a lot of nonsense, actually, in those days. Looking back, I've done really moving account of Bolsover Castle and the revival of chivalry. And I don't think Bolsover Castle has anything to do with the revival of chivalry at all.
I mean, also, Mark, you know, more recently, of course, you've written an enormous amount outside the world of architectural history. Indeed, I believe you're completing a rather racy novel at the present time. When did the sort of the wider literary career begin? Were you writing even as a schoolboy about other things?
I didn't write about anything except buildings for a very long time. And then I just thought it'd be amusing to write about other things. I mean, write about myself, really, actually. So I read these two books, Friendships and Enthusiasms.
When did you find your voice as a writer? Was that something that came very easily to you through reading, or is it something you had to work very hard to establish, and, you know, coming through country life and, you know, the regular turnaround of things?
Yes. I had to work quite hard, sort of editing what I'd written, to make it seem as though it was written very easily, but it wasn't. It was quite hard work, I found, actually, shaping one's prose.
And when did it come? When did your voice come?
When did it come? Well, straight away, I suppose, but I mean, only as a result of work. Well, there was country life, I suppose, which, where I really got going, because I had to write something every few weeks, you know, to a date line, so you just had to get it out.
That's a familiar feeling.
You know that.
I realise my time is already running short. It's like the Christmas in the different Christmases in Dickens, isn't it? Each of us have our short period of time with Mark. At the last thing I'd like, before you push my hat down over my head and extinguish me, I'd like to ask about your feeling about Elizabethan architecture now. I mean, when you reprint Smithson, you talk about how poorly many of the buildings that you studied and loved had fared. Mm-hmm. And how do you feel, and you've described how different going to Bolsover then was, or Hardwick then was, yeah, to today. How do you feel about Elizabethan architecture today? Do you feel it's a fashionable subject once more, or something completely different?
Well, as far as the National Trust is concerned, it seems to be an unfashionable subject. All they are concerned is having a nice day out with the kids, as far as I can see. But I don't know. I mean, I did try myself to write something which would be readable for everybody. And I didn't know. Perhaps I had some success in that way. But now, the situation, you know, it was very selfish, really, to enjoy these buildings on one's own. And you obviously, interpretation centres and so on are necessary, because people want them, because they want to have the building explained to them. So I can't say I couldn't possibly say I'm against them. But I do sort of rather nostalgically think of those days when you had the whole place to yourself.
Do you think you would have entered into your own career if it hadn't been for your personal experience of staying at Hardwick?
No, I think I was already looking at buildings. I mean, Hardwick sort of brought it to a consummation, so to speak, but I think probably, and it's very interesting to think someone become an architectural historian. The first building I remember being turned on by was the Romanesque church at Melbourne in Derbyshire, which is totally different. You know, it's another world altogether. But that's actually the first building that excited me, aged about 12 or 13, I think. And as I was saying, when I first went to Hardwick as a little boy, or even slightly older boy, it didn't turn me on in the way it gradually did, just more and more and more. But I suspect that if Hardwick hadn't been there, I would still have become an architectural historian, doing something quite different, obviously. But
maybe you've written about James Wyatt. On which happy note, I now pass over to Michael to ask. Well, I'll let Michael ask his own questions.
Mark, it's already been mentioned, but in tracing the route that took you to the 19th century and the Victorians, I think one might start with country life, perhaps, because I realise that another anniversary that we're celebrating is it's the 65th anniversary of your first article.
Is it really? Country Life,
which
was on
Longleat.
But
that was actually 2 years before you joined the staff in 1958 as an architectural writer. How did that come about?
Well, I was looking for a job, and I, having done my thesis, and I tried the Ministry of Works, as it were, in those days, citing as my references the Duke of Wellington and Rupert Gunnis, which cut no ice at all with these ridiculous amateurs. So I didn't get that job. And then I tried for the National Trust, and I don't know why. I thought I was made for it in a way, but I had a bad interview, so I didn't get that. And then, fortunately for me, Gordon Nares, who was one of the three architectural writers on Country Life, died. And a job there came up quite unexpectedly. So I put in for it, and I got it.
And very often I know at Country Life, once you started as a writer, they had a book waiting for you. There was something they wanted you to do. Yeah. And at that stage, Christopher Hussey had just published the Late Georgians, or Country Houses. So was it almost immediately it was suggested that you might look at the Victorians, or was that your idea?
There was one reason why they took me on. Because Christopher Hussey had just started writing about Victorian houses, and he wanted me to carry on. And so I did, and it was thanks to him that I joined the Victorian Society the year after I joined Country Life. And I gradually became more and more aware of Victorian architecture.
Because one looks back, and it is extraordinary what fresh territory it was. I mean, you were the first person to write any serious academic articles about William Burgess.
Yes.
In your early articles on Cardiff Castle, which I think was 1961 or so on. I mean, was there much resistance to you writing about such buildings in the rather stately and occasionally genteel pages of Country Life?
Yes. I mean, I got very caught up by Burgess. And quite a few of the houses I wrote about. Others I just found it extraordinary, like Bear Wood. I couldn't say. I thought it was a beautiful house, but it was an absolutely fascinating house because of the planning. And the complex planning of Victorian country houses fascinated me more and more. The way it was all split up into different realms for bachelors and unmarried women and servants the same, you know, male servants, all carefully separated from each other. And this terrific sort of substructure which of servants which supported the whole thing. I got more and more interested in that.
I looked back at the original reviews of the Victorian Country House when it came out, and it should be said perhaps that Country Life was going to publish it, but then in the late 60s it closed down its book publishing arm, which was why the first edition was published by Oxford University Press. But the early reviews, I mean, they all comment on how wonderful the social history is. So it leads really to the inevitable question. I mean, did the Victorian Country Houses, was there a straight line from there to what remains your most famous book? And probably the single most influential work in architectural history in the past half century, Life in the English Country House. Yeah.
Yes, it all started from the Victorian Country House, I think, yes. Robert Smithson got sort of respectful reviews, but only a very small sale. And it was the Victorian Country House which sold well and got lots of reviews and really established my reputation. I mean, that's what got me going.
And did the Victorian Society make use of you? I mean, were you pulled into conservation battles at that stage? Because, of course, the 60s was the sort of heroic age of conservation in the 19th century.
Yes, we had these two great battles, Euston Arch and the Corn
Exchange.
And that took me over into conservation, really, because it was so upsetting. And we had this great Victorian Society battle, which failed to save them.
Before I have to hand over into the 20th century, but thinking of the things that came out of your interest, particularly in the 19th century, there are so many books. I began scrolling through your entry in the British Library catalogue, and it goes on for page after page after page. But one book I'd like to mention, because I think it was your first one on the Victorian subject after Victorian Country Houses, the Victorian Pubs. Was that almost deliberately you wanted to do something?
Yes, it was absolutely deliberate that I thought, having written about the upper classes, I would then write about the middle classes, which was the Queen Anne style, which was sort of middle and upper middle classes, and then move on and write about the lower and lower middle classes with the Victorian pubs. And that was a deliberate choice. But also Victorian pubs was intriguing because it hadn't occurred to anyone that they could be documented, like Hardwick or something, you know. But when I looked into it, I found there was more and more documentation, including drawings and plans and everything, and the names of the architects and the craftsmen involved, which one could disinter, and that was absolutely fascinating.
And more even than the Victorian Country Houses book, I mean, it's a record of what's been lost, because, I mean, how many of those pubs that you illustrate?
Yes, indeed. So few of them are still as they were when I wrote about them.
Yeah. But Life in the English Country House, just to return to that, and that began with Slade Lectures at Oxford, didn't it?
It
began with your Slade Lectures at Oxford.
That's right, yes.
And did you suggest that as a subject, or were you approaching it?
Yes. I was asked to give the Slade Lectures, but I could choose the subject. And it just, to talk about houses and their social background was just something I got interested in, and it was an obvious choice, so it was my choice, and the lectures went down very well and became Life in the English Country House a year or two later.
Before I hand over, I'd just like to mention finally, because it's a book which I enormously admire, which is your book on of chivalry and the English gentleman, The Return to Camelot, which is an extraordinary book in some ways, because of course it links everything. So it actually starts with the Elizabethans,
yes,
and goes right through to the Victorians, and then ends up with the First World War. So it takes us into the 20th century. I mean, how did that come about? What was the seed that sowed that book?
Again, I think it developed out of the Victorian country house, probably just enlarging it to a bigger, wider subject. But I don't know what got me going. I mean, what did happen was that people were, after Life in the English Country House, people were expecting another book on the country house, and they were totally mystified by the Return to Camelot, which is actually, I would say, my favourite book.
Well, that takes us into 1918, anyway. So hand over to Catherine.
Yeah. Well, I'm here to talk to you about your 20th century work, but I'm listening now. I remember that actually the first work of yours that I came across was Sweetness and Light, when I was an undergraduate at Newnham and wanting to know not just about the architecture, but about, you know, the experience of being an undergraduate and the relationship between that and the buildings. Mm. And I loved it, so I was very grateful to you for that.
Very good, yeah.
Moving on to the 20th century, I think you have at least, you know, four ways in which you've been influential on 20th century architectural history. I mean, as a straightforward historian, But obviously you were also writing critiques of new contemporary buildings, including two of the ones that I think are, you know, the most interesting in 1960s buildings in Oxford, the ABK building at Keble, you did a building study of, and the Florey building at Queen's. Both of them have been cases that I've been fighting for 20th century, and your prose and your enthusiasm has been an enormous help for us in doing that. But we've also talked briefly, I mean, you had a very active role in the conservation movement.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think the part that plays in the overall history of 20th century architecture is only now beginning to be studied. And I didn't know until I was preparing for tonight as well that you studied as an architect, and you studied at the Bartlett, and then you went to work in your year out for the GLC in Architects Department.
Yes, I did indeed.
Yes.
And I designed a school.
Yes, yes, I know.
And pretty second rate it was.
Well, and I know that when you did your National Sound Archives, you said it was still there and you enjoyed it.
I think it's still there.
No, it's not.
It's gone.
It was demolished in 2015.
It was a Meccano job.
Yes, you know, it was a Mace system built.
And I only designed it because my boss, who was supposed to be designing it, had a nervous breakdown, I think, so I surreptitiously designed it instead of him. But no, it's not a building I'm proud of. And I think basically, you know, I was totally divided as should I become an architect, should I become an architectural historian? And so after my years at Country Life, I thought I'd have a go at becoming an architect. And it, quite honestly, it became clear that I wouldn't be a good architect.
Yeah.
It wasn't the way my mind worked or something. The way my mind worked was in the history and actually writing about buildings rather than designing them. Yeah. And I don't think I would ever have been a good architect.
But I mean, I studied architecture only as an undergraduate, and I've always felt that it gives me a different approach to how I do architectural history.
Mm-hmm.
And also a different way of communicating with architects. And I wondered whether you felt...
I suppose, yes, I've often wondered what I got out of those 5 years, wasn't it? A long time.
Yeah, it's a long time. You stuck it longer than I did.
Yes, and possibly it did give me an insight into buildings which I wouldn't have had otherwise. But I'm not even sure about that, really. What was interesting was just getting to meet a lot of students younger than myself. It was just a very fascinating time, and I made some good friends. And
you met J.M. Richards?
Yes.
Bob Maxwell. Who else?
Celia Maxwell, who's...
Who
did the standard thing of marrying your supervisor. She married Bob, but she was a good friend. There's a charming, nice Jane Tanfield. I don't know. I mean, I had several relationships of various strengths.
So it wasn't wasted time.
It wasn't. I don't think it was a waste of time. But it was a long time, certainly. Yeah. And actually, I, in a way, quite admired myself, because while I was working there, I was also writing The Victorian Country House,
right,
which was quite an effort, because it was an extraordinary change in lifestyle, becoming an architectural student. Mm. And to sort of move from Victorian Country House to Bartlett School, Victorian Country House, was quite an effort.
Yeah. I didn't realise you were doing that simultaneously.
That's
impressive. I know that you don't like being asked what your favourite building is.
Yeah.
But I mean, I'm surprised that you were willing to pick a favourite book just now. But anyway, I mean, one of my favourite buildings is definitely Dennis Lasdon's National Theatre. Mm-hmm. And I absolutely, looking back at those Architectural Review articles, absolutely love the way that you wrote about that. And I wanted to just read a quote, because, I mean, we've talked a bit about how fluent your writing is, but we haven't... I was just really, really impressed by this, and I just want to share it with people. So your description of the National Theatre goes like this. The sum total is like nothing else, a rich, complex, at times mysterious, sometimes confusing, but almost always enjoyable sequence of spaces. Where columns of delicious slenderness soar through several stories of open space, or transfixed staircases like skewers, where climbing each flight of stairs reveals a new vista, and the space of every vista vanishes enticingly out of sight around it, each corner.
It sounds good.
So, I mean, you said at the time that, you know, that you felt that the National Theatre was unlikely as a landmark to inspire immediate affection, but it's a smoulderer, not a fizzer, which I love. And I think that's definitely true. I think everyone now probably would agree that
it's
that's a fabulous building.
You know, boats, tourist boats used to go up the Thames, past the National Theatre, and the loudspeaker would boom, "We are now passing the ugliest building in London."
I mean, does it still excite you, the National Theatre?
Yes, it does, absolutely, yes.
I can't resist this because, you know, I'm a great Concrete fan, and I didn't have you down for being a Concrete fan at all. Mm. You described the Concrete as looks like something between canvas and fur, and it's caressing rather than cold.
Yeah.
Very like that.
Yes. Pleasing me. I wrote these nice things.
I think they're incredibly evocative and incredibly accessible and compelling, which is great, and we need more of that today, I think. Can we move on to I think your most extraordinary and compelling work, your biography of Jim Sterling, which came out in 2000. And I know that you've described that as a process of largely stitching together oral history interviews that you did. And I would just be really interested to know how you felt that process of being a historian using those materials differed from the archival work that you've been doing.
Well, I found it absolutely fascinating because I'd never done anything. You know, I'd always written about people who were safely dead. It was a tragedy, but it was lucky for me, really, that Jim died relatively young, so there were so many people around who I could talk to. And I'd never done that before. And so it was a whole new form of life, really, recording these people and then editing, editing the, which is very important, and which I think I did quite well. But one half of the book, really, is, and probably the most interesting, is these recorded conversations with all sorts of different people who came into Jim's life one way or another.
Yes, it feels like it's a real kind of capturing a segment of the century as well as the architectural story as well. And do you regret at all not doing the great Lasdon biography, which I'm sure you could have done?
No, actually, that had never occurred to me. It never occurred to me because William Curtius had a sort of had a corner in. And he wrote it, you know, and it never occurred to me. I enjoyed writing the articles that I did write, but it never occurred to me that I might write an actual life of him.
Right.
Whereas with Jim, well, I did, you know. And I was so excited by his buildings, which again were very controversial.
Mm-hmm. Yes, when you wrote about the Florey building, you were like, you know, oh, all the fuss and bother about how it's, you know, teething problems will all have gone away in 5 years. I don't think you were quite so spot on with that one.
No.
How do you think time has treated Stirling's buildings?
And they've gradually had the money spent on them, which should have been spent on them when they were built. They were all built on the cheap, a lot of them.
Yes, yeah.
It's just so extraordinary. I mean, what is extraordinary is, you know, beautiful, ugly, beautiful, ugly. That Nicholas Pevsner, who hated Jim's buildings, said that they are actively ugly, and I found them actively beautiful.
Yes.
It's the same with Butterfield.
What I'd like to say, exactly. You wrote about Milton Ernest, you wrote about Burgess, which people really despised for the same reason.
And Paul Thompson, again, was interesting about Butterfield, that he didn't, you know, John Summerson was very good at coining phrases which weren't always apt, I think, and he talked about Butterfield's sadistic hatred of beauty. and Paul sort of pointed out that wasn't the way his mind worked at all, or what the results were like, really, once you'd understood what it was all about.
Simon, you wanted to ask a question, is that right?
Mark, Simon Thurley, it's very interesting that in your interview just then that your role in conservation was mentioned a couple of times, but I think it was under-egged because I think you've been very, very influential in the sort of field of conservation. And the thing that I wanted to ask you about was this famous list of the 10 most important Victorian houses that had to be saved.
Oh, yes.
And again and again, we used to go back to this at English Heritage when, you know, there were big crises with Victorian country houses, and it became the Bible, this list. And I've never known how the list came about. And who were you asked to do it, or did you just invent it? I mean, how did it happen?
Who asked me to make that list? I cannot remember. and I think it was probably a very bad thing to make such a list, because there were lots of buildings which probably should have been on the list, and then when they got into trouble, people said, well, they're not on Mark Girouard's list, so we can do what we like with them.
I'm not sure that it ever happened that way round. It certainly happened the other way round, that if there was a question and it was on the list, that everybody went mad to try and to save it. So I don't think that you did any disservice.
I don't think there were any buildings on the list that shouldn't have been on it, were there?
No, absolutely not.
Jeremy Musson. That it leads on quite well, I think. You mentioned the discipline of writing for Country Life, and I wondered whether you could say something about working with architectural photographers.
I actually would say that the great Country Life tradition of architectural photography had become a rather stale formula by the time I arrived on Country Life. you know, you had officers and other ranks, and the photographers were the other ranks, and the officer, which is you, would go to a building and draw a plan of it with little arrows showing where the photographer should put up his camera and take his view, which he then dutifully did. But he also carefully lit the room so that there were no awkward shadows or anything. And also, he obliterated any sign of human life in these rooms. The only thing that was occasionally allowed with enormous daring was to have a photograph which showed the owner's dog in front of the fireplace. I just liked the idea, I suppose, the Piper Betjeman school, which you get in the Shell guides, of taking buildings in natural light. And I tried to get Country Life to see it that way, and I got nowhere, really. I did get John Piper to do one article for them, which actually weren't his best photographs, and they couldn't really understand them, so it came to nothing. The most daring article I wrote for Country Life in terms of photography, and I can't remember who the photographer was a Bairns Manor, you know, which was totally derelict. And the idea of photographing a derelict house in a romantic way was completely new to Country Life, and I had some difficulty in getting them to agree to do it, although I think it was one of my best and most interesting articles.
It was Alex Starkey, I think, who photographed that for you. Exactly. And there are also a very funny set of photographs in the Country Life archive of you with Alex Starkey walking round Mereworth Castle together for no obvious reason and admiring things and being photographed doing it. Why?
This was totally artificial and it was for some form of publicity. I forget what form, but anyway, you know, we were set up to do something quite imaginary, which we weren't actually doing.
Did you always go with the photographers?
No, very seldom. You just did this little plan with arrows, and they went afterwards, and they always waited for perfect weather, too. The idea of photographing a building with a stormy sky was not acceptable. And in the, you know, in the huge Avery Tipping books, which really had the same philosophy behind them, but they were so, well, they were magnificent folio volumes, and they were so, somehow so beautifully done, that they were very, very splendid. And I felt that in Country Life, it had become stale, really. And there was a Country Life tradition, really, that you photographed houses surrounded by acres of lawn, with the house sort of quite small in the middle of them. And what my wife did in Victorian Country House, I think great effect, was to take all these technically beautiful photographs and cut them right down to the building. I think actually that revolutionized a lot of Country Life photographs. They were far more effective done that way.
Pete Smith, Mark, is there a house in England that you have never been to and always wanted to get into but failed?
The Palazzo, is it Del Te in Mantua? but a country house that I would have liked to write about and was turned down. I don't think any country house rejected me, actually. I mean, they were quite keen on the whole to be written about in Country Life.
Did you ever get into Welbeck Abbey?
Oh, yes, a lot, yeah. Actually, I never thought about writing about it because it was such a curious building. It was such a sort of cock up, really. I mean, there were these underground rooms which appeared not to be underground when you were in them, and it was very fascinating. I could have written some fascinating articles, but now would they have let me? Was it was what she called Lady Anne Cavendish Bentinck? Lady Anne Bentinck, wasn't it, in those days, who was always friendly to me, and she put me up, and I stayed with her, and so on. But I think possibly she wouldn't have allowed articles to be published.
Hmm. And why was that?
What?
Why was that?
Just didn't like publicity. Some owners were worried about burglary, and so at a certain stage, I was no longer allowed to have plans, which was a great pity.
Malcolm Ayres, just curiosity, did you choose the houses you could write about for Country Life, or were you told which houses you were going to write about?
I mean, initially I didn't choose because Christopher Hussey had already had several houses photographed, so then I took those on and wrote about it. But after that, I don't think, just occasionally, like when Winston Churchill died, I was forced, we had no permission to write about it, and I was forced to sneak round the various roads around Chartwell sort of to get some idea of what it was like, and then write an article. I forget how the photographs were taken, or they may have been old photographs. And the same thing happened when the wedding, Princess Alexandra, I think, wasn't it? I mean, it was another sort of occasion, some sort of royal occasion, which was getting a lot of publicity, so Country Life wanted an article. And so they told me to do it. But basically, on the whole, I always chose my own houses.
Thank you.
Claire Gapper. Mark, so having sent the photographer off, did you then get to choose which photographs went into the article?
Yes, I did. I did do that. One thing about the photographs is that when I photographed buildings which had advertisements on the wall, the advertisements had to be airbrushed out because I couldn't, Country Life couldn't be seen to be advertising anyone. But I don't think there were any problems. There were problems of layout, I think, because again, the idea that photographs of details should be very large instead of very small because of they were details, didn't happen. I mean, that was never really accepted in Country Life in my time. And in the layout, the details tended to be printed much too small.
Robert Thorne, it's characteristic, I think, of the questions this evening that they've become skewed towards questions about the country life and your association with country life and country houses. And you've written about so many other things, about towns, about pubs, about contemporary buildings. Do you sometimes feel slightly a sense of disquiet that you're so closely associated with writing about the country house, when that version of British history is now so much in question?
Yes, I must say I rather was slightly upset when the very nice interview with me by John was published in Country Life, that I was referred to as Dr. Mark Girouard, the country house historian. But I don't like being thought of as a country house historian because, you know, I've written about country houses a good deal, but I've also written about a great deal of other buildings. And I think some of my most interesting work has been right away from the country house.
There have been other historians, and I'm thinking primarily here of David Cannadine and his wife, Linda Colley, who've quite rightly emphasised the primacy, or what should be the primacy, in British history of the industrial mercantile past rather than the country house past.
I don't think there is such a concentration on the country house these days. I mean, possibly there was when when I wrote Life in the English Country House, one reason why it was a great seller was because country houses were extremely fashionable, that owners were going back to live in their country houses, that all sorts of enthusiasts were buying country houses and doing them up, usually without enough money, so they had to sell them in the end. But country houses were very much in, and I don't think they are to the same extent now. I would have thought that there was a lot of interest in buildings other than country houses. Mm. I don't think they dominate the scene at all these days.
Thank you. Well, I think we need to bring it to a close. So can I ask you all to thank Mark for all his responses to your questions?